That was Open the Eyes of My Heart. We haven't sung that in a long time. Be good to sing that one again tonight. Welcome, everyone. Glad you're here. Welcome to all of you joining us online. We're glad you're here. A number of announcements to make. Many of you remember Christine Ide. Christine worked here for a number of years as DCE, and she retired from Crossview at the end of last year, beginning of this year, and she's now back at St. Matthew. She's using some of her many skills right now, helping out in our preschool daycare, doing some mentoring and coaching, and she's also going to start helping out with children's messages. So welcome back, Christine. It is great to have you here, you and Norm both here. Next, tomorrow is our SECA fundraiser. We have brats and root beer in the parking lot. So I know you're here tonight, but if you want to come back tomorrow around noon, 11:45, and get a brat and a root beer and make a donation to SECA, that would be great. 100% of our sales will go to SECA. A Thrivent grant has covered 100% of the foods. That means we can give all the money to SECA. And then next Saturday night, is our polka service. We can't do a sit-down meal, but we are doing to-go German dinners. But you need to see Carol tonight or let her know before Monday. We're trying to get 50 before Monday, and then we'll do the to-go dinners. And then also, you know, we set a goal last year to every once in a while, at least four times a year, do Sunday school together, get all the kids and all the adults and all the teens together. We were going to call it LIFT, Living in Faith Together. It was to go with our RISE theme from last year. Well, COVID hit and that never happened, but we are going to take a stab at that next Sunday, a week from tomorrow, Reformation Day. We're all going to gather in the gym and spread out, and we'll do intergenerational Sunday school that we'll still call LIFT, Living in Faith Together. So plan to join us for that. Tonight in the gospel, we meet a guy named Bartimaeus. If you read the heading in the Bible, he's often referred to as blind Bartimaeus. We sometimes refer to him as blind Bartimaeus. But, you know, we've learned, let's not define people by their disabilities. We don't do that anymore. We use more people-centered language. And so let's call him good example Bartimaeus, because that's what he is for us tonight. Good example Bartimaeus. Let's begin with prayer. Father, as we come into worship tonight, we come needing you to open our eyes, not the physical eyes so much like you did for Bartimaeus, but open our spiritual eyes, open the eyes of our heart, open us up to see just how much you love us, see just how valuable we are and how valuable every one of our neighbors is to you. Let us see that love of Christ in new ways tonight, Lord, and then find new ways to share it. We worship in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. Our worship begins the way our lives in Christ begin in baptism. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dreamed.
Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy.
Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them.
The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy.
The Lord gives sight to the blind.
The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous.
I will lead the blind by the ways they have not known. Along unfamiliar paths, I will guide them.
I will turn darkness into light before them, and make rough places smooth.
These are the things I will do. I will not forsake them. The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor.
He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind.
To set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. What do you want me to do for you? Jesus asked him. The blind man said, When we look at God's solution to the problem of our sin, we see just how drastic the problem is. Let's confess to God now just how drastically we need the forgiveness that comes from the perfect life and innocent death of Jesus. Give us courage to take risks, which will result in not only our own transformation, but also in transformational opportunities for others.
Forgive our stubborn insistence on living in darkness. Take our hands and lead us to the light. In Jesus' name and for his sake.
Amen.
Thank you.
Hear the good news. Just as we sang, God's love breaks every barrier down. Just as we sang, God does welcome us and pardon us and cleanse us and relieve us of the burden of our sin and its punishment death. Jesus takes all that upon himself at the cross. So it's my joy and my privilege as a called and ordained servant of the word to stand in his stead and speak the words he commands me to speak. All of your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And God's people say,
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, as we worship you and celebrate your glorious resurrection, open our eyes so that we may see. Open the eyes of our minds to learning and understanding. Open the eyes of our hearts to love and compassion. Open the eyes of our souls to see our spiritual selves during our time of worship. In Jesus' name, amen. We take this time to greet each other. God's peace.
Hello. When I heard that the theme for tonight was vision and clear vision, the first thing that came to my mind was that many of you probably also can relate to is the need to wear glasses and what happens when we don't. And I thought, I can't read anymore without my glasses. I can't drive anymore without my glasses, and I need my glasses, otherwise it's just hazy and it's blurry. And in the same way with our lives, that we need Christ. Our theme this year is following Jesus. And as we follow Jesus, our direction gets clearer. And that as we have that, what does that mean? But this past couple of weeks, our verses that we've been reading have been on love. And that God asks us to love and love each other. And that's for all of us, but with that then comes serving. And as we serve, that's a little bit different for everybody because each person has their own gifts and their own talents as to how they can serve. And so as we pray tonight and tomorrow and every day, that we think of how can we serve and how can we love and be Jesus to those around us. Will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the clarity that comes through Jesus. Guide us and direct us to love and serve those around us. Amen.
The Old Testament lesson for today is from Jeremiah 31. This is what the Lord says: sing with joy for Jacob, shout for the foremost of the nations, make your praises heard, and say, Lord, save your people, the remnant of Israel. See, I will bring them from the land of the north and gather them from the ends of the earth. Among them will be the blind and the lame, expectant mothers and women in labor. A great throng will return. They will come with weeping. They will pray as I bring them back. I will lead them beside the streams of water on a level path where they will not stumble, because I am Israel's father and Ephraim is my firstborn son. The word of the Lord. Our epistle lesson is from Hebrews chapter 7. Now there have been many of those priests since death prevented them from continuing in office, but because Jesus lives forever, he has a permanent priesthood. Therefore, he is able to save completely those who come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for them. Such a high priest truly meets our needs. One who is holy, blameless, pure, set apart from sinners, exalted above the heavens. Unlike the other high priests, he does not need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people. He sacrificed for their sins once for all when he offered himself. For the law appoints as high priests men in all their weakness. But the oath, which came after the law, appointed the Son, who has been made perfect forever. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise as you are able for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark chapter 10.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then they came to Jericho. As Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city, a blind man, Bartimaeus, which means Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus stopped and said, call him. So they called to the blind man, cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you. Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. What do you want me to do for you? Jesus asked him. The blind man said, Rabbi, I want to see. Go, said Jesus, your faith has healed you. Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated.
Thank you.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord Jesus. Amen. So get Bartimaeus tonight. As I mentioned, Bartimaeus is the good example. It's, you know, there's so many unique God things in this story. I wish I had an hour just to talk with you about all of them, but I won't do that. I'll keep it fairly short. But, you know, Bartimaeus plays the role of the good example here. Mark puts this story in his gospel right after another story where Jesus uses the exact same words. Just as he said to Bartimaeus in this story, "What do you want me to do for you?" He said that exact same thing to James and John in the previous story. The difference is they were coming to Jesus looking for the two best spots in the kingdom. They wanted something that fed their ego. Bartimaeus says, appeals to Jesus not on the basis of ego, but on the basis of mercy. "Lord, have mercy." And Jesus says, "What do you want me to do?" Bartimaeus says, "Give me something I don't deserve. Have mercy." And Bartimaeus is another example just in his persistence. He's calling out, he's making a scene. The townspeople are scared, they're irritated or annoyed. The Bible says they rebuke him and tell him to be quiet. That means they fussed at him and told him to shut up. Okay, here's the local celebrity, the most popular guy in the area is coming to town, and here's Bartimaeus making a scene. Jesus isn't here for Bartimaeus, not in the eyes of the townspeople he wasn't. But Bartimaeus doesn't care. He just keeps calling out for Jesus. He knows Jesus has what he needs, and he just keeps calling out for Jesus. But you know, even more important than Bartimaeus' persistence is Jesus' response to him. He stops. Jesus just stops and tells the crowd, "Call him. Tell him to come here." And they called the blind man. They said, "Cheer up, on your feet. He's calling you." So throwing off his cloak, he jumped up and came to Jesus. Then Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" And I think this is one of the most important moments in the gospel for telling us about Jesus. What do you want me to do for you? Jesus doesn't assume that Bartimaeus wants to be healed of his blindness. He doesn't assume that Bartimaeus sees his blindness as a disability. Jesus knew what was best for Bartimaeus, but he wasn't going to force his will on him. What do you want me to do for you? Jesus doesn't impose his will on us. He doesn't make assumptions about what we need or what we want. But he comes to us with that same question, "What do you want me to do for you?" And by asking that question, Jesus is causing us to delve deeply into our faith, into who we are. You know, on the surface, it sounds pretty simple. This is like an exchange. What can a follower of Jesus get for me? But when we start to answer this question, it begins to reveal our ego and our fear. What do you want me to do for you? Let's sit for a minute with that question. What do you want me to do for you, St. Matthew? Well, wouldn't it be great if St. Matthew could be full of people? Where's that answer coming from? Is it coming from our heart? Is it coming from our ego? "What do you want me to do for you?" says Jesus. Well, we've got voters' meeting coming up in about a month. Got to set a budget for the year. It'd be great if you could assure us we'd have all the money to do everything we want to do. Where's that question? Where's that answer coming from? Coming from our fear, not from our heart. What do you want me to do for you? Jesus, could you make all of our ministries a success? Where's that answer coming from? That's an ego answer there. What do you want me to do for you? Could you make me successful as a minister, as a follower of Jesus? Could I be fruitful and productive? Well, maybe we're getting a little closer, but that still doesn't sound quite right, does it? Help me to do more, to try harder, to do better. Still not right. Doesn't feel right. What do you want me to do for you? Jesus asked. Help me love better. Help me love harder. Help me love more. Oh, now we're getting really close. We're breaking through the ego and breaking through the fear. But I think the best answer we could give that is the same one Bartimaeus gave. What do you want me to do? Teacher, let me see. Jesus, let us see. Jesus, let us see just how much you love us. Jesus, let us see just how much is ours because of the perfect life and the innocent death at the cross. Jesus, let us see just how cherished we are. And then Jesus, let us see just how special and precious and beautiful our neighbors are to you. And let us see how hungry they are for love. And then let's share that love with them. You see, if we really answer that question, sounds like a simple question, but we have to break through layers of ego and fear to really get to the answer. We have to dig through the superficial and get to the real Christ-like. And when we get there, we realize that as followers of Jesus, our greatest desire is not success or notoriety, but it's love. It's to love and to be loved by God. Teacher, let us see. Let us see above all the distractions and the noise and all the divisions and all the things that can isolate us from one another, and let us see Jesus. Let us see. You know, Bartimaeus occupies a unique spot in Mark's gospel. This is both a healing story and a call story. It's his healing that enables his call, and it's his call that completes his healing. Jesus says to him, go, your faith has healed you. And then the next thing we see is Bartimaeus follows Jesus down the road. And I think this is it's worth a close look on our part, this relationship between our healing and our call. Because I think all too often we look and we see what disqualifies us. You know, we see our problems, our sin, our busyness, our brokenness, our apathy, our in slavery to a busy schedule, or slavery to a habit. How could someone as unhealed as us do something really significant for Jesus? And we don't have to wait very long at all for the answer. Bartimaeus didn't. The people in the crowd say, cheer up, get up, he's calling you. So he threw off his cloak, he sprang up, and he came to Jesus. He was still blind when he did that, right? He would have needed someone's help to get to Jesus. But there he is, still throwing away his cloak and coming to Jesus. And I don't want to pick up on that throwing away the cloak for a minute, too. This is just another one of these unique God things in the story. Bartimaeus was homeless. He was a beggar. His cloak was one of his few assets. It was the only thing that kept him warm. It was his covering. And yet, while he's still blind, he throws it off, unhealed, and makes his way to Jesus. What does that tell us about us? What does it tell us about all those disqualifications we think we have? None of them. None of them matter. None of them get in Jesus' way. And another, what I see is just a remarkable turn in this remarkable story, is that Bartimaeus isn't the only one who experiences the healing of Jesus here. You see what happens to the crowd? The crowd begins with cruelty and exclusion. They want Bartimaeus, stay away from Jesus. You know, shut up, go away, be quiet, quit making a scene. That's my paraphrase. It said, many sternly ordered him to be quiet, but he cried out even more, Son of David, have mercy on me. And look at the pivotal moment. Jesus does not call Bartimaeus directly. He says to the crowd, you call him. You call him. And look what they do. This is their redemption. And they called the blind man, saying to him, call him here. And they called the blind man, saying to him, cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you. This is the crowd's conversion, the crowd's healing. They go from wanting to push someone away from Jesus to inviting someone into Jesus' embrace. They go from seeing Bartimaeus as an embarrassment to seeing Bartimaeus as someone that Jesus loves. This happens to us. This is our healing and our call as well. You know, there's a reason Jesus says that love your neighbor is the second most important commandment. It's the second most important thing we can do. We love God, and then we love our neighbor. And through that sharing that love, people change. Redemption happens. The power of the cross is delivered by imperfect humans like us who have their eyes open and see people the way God sees them and then learn to love them. This is not just about us. This is about community. Bartimaeus calls Jesus. Jesus calls the crowd. The crowd calls Bartimaeus. And Jesus calls Bartimaeus to follow him. He's healed. He's called. He followed Jesus down the road. So if we want to learn from Bartimaeus, if we want to be like Bartimaeus, where do we start? Let's start the way Bartimaeus did. Jesus, have mercy. Give us something we don't deserve. And Jesus says, what do you want me to do? We say, let me see. Let me see. And then we follow Jesus down the road. Amen and amen. Let's stand up and confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. Third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. We have a couple of prayer requests tonight. Carol would like prayers for her mom, Anna Hers. Anna has been diagnosed with COVID, and so prayers for her healing. And then we pray for Louise Roberts and her family at the death of her cousin, Carla. We pray for all of Carla's family as well. We pray. Oh, Lord Jesus, we were blind, and you've opened our eyes. And we pray, Lord, you continue to open our eyes wider and wider to the love you have for us, to the love you have for all the people around us. And then let us learn, Lord, to follow you in showing that love. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for those who await your healing. We pray for Anna and for all those we name silently before you now. Father, our heart's desire is that you would heal all of these, restore them to lives of health and service to you. And while they wait for healing, Lord, fill their lives with hope. And we pray for all who grieve, especially Louise and the family of Carla Sikora. We pray that you comfort them. Be for them resurrection and life. Surround them with those who will be comfort. Be your comfort and strength. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for our community. And tonight we lift up Seika. We ask your blessing upon our fundraiser for Seika tomorrow. Thank you for all that they do and all the needs of hunger and nutrition that they meet. And we pray, Lord, that they would be blessed by our activity tomorrow. We pray, Lord, for others in our community dealing with all sorts of other burdens, the burdens of not just hunger, but unemployment, poverty, the burdens of hatred and bigotry and racism, the burdens of violence, war, and terrorism. And we pray, Lord, that you'd work through your church, make us instruments of peace and justice and freedom. Give our elected officials all that they need to govern in the way that you want them to govern. Bless our military with all that they need to carry out the task you've given them, that all people everywhere might live in freedom and justice and peace. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we pray for those confined to their homes and nursing homes, for Carol Heinrichs, Randy Peterson, Minnie Schrader, Ruby Cool. Comfort them with your presence and assure them of your love. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for other churches in our community. Today we pray for First Lutheran Church and Pastor Bonnie and Pastor Jill and pray that you'd bless them as people and pastor and continue to open their eyes to see how wide and deep the love of Jesus is. Lord, in your mercy. We pray all these things, Lord, knowing that you hear them, for we ask them in the name of Jesus. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let's take a moment and reflect on what it is that we're doing as we come to the Lord's Supper. Jesus was eating the Passover meal with his disciples, something faithful Jews had been doing for centuries. And it was the night before his death. He took the unleavened bread that was part of the Passover meal, and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body." And then he took the wine that was also part of the Passover meal and said, "Take and drink. This is my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sins." Body and blood. You know, we can't see that. Our eyes of faith don't allow us to see. Our physical eyes don't allow us to see that. It's only with eyes of faith we see that Jesus is really present in some way that we can't physically see or mentally understand. And he's present to forgive our sins. That's what we believe about the Lord's Supper, which we set aside for the Lord's use with the Lord's words. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Take and eat the body of Christ. Take and drink the blood of Christ. Now may this true body and blood of our Lord Jesus strengthen us and preserve us in true faith to life everlasting. Serve the Lord in peace. Amen. I'll leave a time of silence now, and I encourage you to use that as a time of thanksgiving, a prayer of thanksgiving following communion. We do give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. We implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Be in the Word this week. Open your Bibles. All this month, we're still looking at growing in love. Now, what it means to follow Jesus in love. This week, though, there aren't verses assigned each day. It's to take the previous verses and to begin using them to see how you can grow in love for God and in love for others. So be reviewing those verses each day this week. And there's a little challenge in the journal if you're following along. Make three goals for loving God and loving others. Now, let's rise for the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. God's people say, Amen. Amen.